Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you. Welcome to worship service at University Mennonite Church. Welcome to those gathered here in the sanctuary. Welcome to those who join us on Zoom. We welcome all who want to learn more about following Jesus. Let's start with a prayer. Heavenly Father, we gather in your presence today with open hearts and open minds to worship you and to learn. We ask that you bless this time of worship so that we may be uplifted and inspired by your presence. We offer this prayer in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship by watching our prelude. This is a compilation of pictures and videos from members of the congregation that show ways that we saw the divine in our lives this week. Just reminded us, last Sunday was Easter, our celebration of the resurrection of Christ. Easter followed the season of Lent, which was named for the lengthening of days from the winter solstice to the spring equinox. And just as the days continue to lengthen as Earth moves towards the summer solstice, we continue this Easter season. The resurrection of Jesus has been celebrated and embraced by Christians for centuries, but that was not immediately the case. Our New Testament reading will tell the story of Thomas and how he needed empirical evidence that Jesus was alive to believe that he had arisen. That familiar story may awaken enduring questions of what's needed for firm knowledge and what is needed for belief. We're going to use a passage from one of the letters of John as our call to worship. That scripture reminded us of the poem from Mary Oliver that we used last week in our Easter service, and we're going to return to that poem as a segue into our lighting of the peace lamp. Hear these words from the beginning of the first letter from John. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard and seen with our eyes, and have looked at and touched with our hands, the Word who is life. This is the subject of our letter. That life came to be. We saw it and bear witness to it. We proclaim to you the eternal life which was with Abba God and was manifested to us. What we have seen and heard, we declare to you, that you may be one with us, as we are one with Abba God, and with the only begotten, Jesus Christ. We write this to fulfill our joy. To fulfill our joy. Joy is not made to be a crumb. Let's consider again the poem, Don't Hesitate, by Mary Oliver, which I think will come up on the screen, yes. If you suddenly and unexpectedly feel joy, don't hesitate. Give in to it. There are plenty of lives and whole towns destroyed or about to be. We are not wise, nor very often kind, and much can never be redeemed. Still, life has some possibility left. Perhaps this is its way of fighting back, that sometimes something happens better than all the riches or power in the world. It could be anything, but very likely you notice it in the instant when love begins. Anyway, that's often the case. Anyway, whatever it is, don't be afraid of its plenty. Joy is not made to be a crumb. That poem begins and ends with joy, but it does not shy away from pain and violence. The poet acknowledges that there are plenty of lives and whole towns destroyed or about to be. Each week we lift our aspirational prayers for peace, and we continue to work for peace, but we are constantly reminded of how far we are from that peace. Members of this congregation frequently share with us their heartfelt and deep concerns, wanting to end suffering, wanting to feed the hungry. And this week we learned of these horrific attacks on aid workers in Gaza. But we persist. We continue to light the peace lamp, and we continue to pray. Father, we see much violence and aggression. We pray that your word and your wisdom would prevail. May nonviolent and peaceful solutions to conflicts be found and embraced. In Jesus' name, amen. Now we have our singing. Mike is going to lead us. Meredith is going to accompany.
Please rise. This is a Easter song and has origins in Tanzania. So if it's unfamiliar, listen for the introduction from Meredith and then we'll join in. Oh, thanks. Let's just sing the English verses in italics below, 1, 2, and 3. Now you can turn in the other hymnal, the blue hymnal worship book, to number 25. I never realized how closely this hymn follows the story in the scripture passage this morning from John chapter 20. So it's an Easter song. I never thought about that.
Jesus, stand among us in your risen power. Let this time of worship be our hour. Breathe the Holy Spirit into
You can support University Mennonite Church with your financial gifts using any of the several ways that are listed in your bulletin. These include online donations, mail, or using the traditional means of putting it in the baskets that are by the door of the sanctuary. We're grateful for these gifts, and let us offer our thanks. Father, we thank you for our material blessings and for these opportunities to support our congregation. We pray that we will use these contributions wisely and in your service. Amen. Our scripture reading today is a familiar story. It's from the Gospel of John, 20th chapter, verses 19 through 31. And it is in your bulletin. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced as they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So when the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord," he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing, you may have life in his name.
Come and see. Come and see. come join me up here, you guys. Can you come all the way up here? Yeah, have a seat. We got some things to do together today. But first off, good morning. It's good to see you all. I'm wondering if there's any food that you eat every day. Timo?
Oatmeal.
Oatmeal. Anything else that any of you guys eat every day? Jonas?
Lunch.
So is there something in lunch that is always there? No, but you always eat lunch. Yeah. Yeah. Anything else? Well, when my kids were little, when we went to grandma's house, there was always one food on the table. No matter what the meal was, there was always bread. And with that bread, there was lots of butter and jam or honey or apple butter, but there was always bread. And bread is something that's eaten around the world, isn't it? Like in some cultures, like we often have sliced bread. Do you guys ever have, Jonas, do you ever have sandwiches for lunch? A type of bread. Yeah. Yeah. Well, in some countries they eat pita bread, right? In some countries they eat tortillas like bread. Well, we are celebrating communion today. Here, I don't know if you guys can see it. And I made some bread earlier this week for us to have. We'll have it later. I made this bread. I took some wheat. This bread is made from wheat. Not all bread is made from wheat, but lots of bread is made from wheat. And I took it and I took some grains of wheat and I ground them up and I mixed them. But we have communion. We celebrate communion with bread and grape juice. And do you know why? Why do we celebrate communion? Jesus in the Last Supper. And what did he say then? Do you remember?
He said, this is the, with the bread, this is my body, and then with the wine, this is my blood.
Yeah, so with the bread, he said, this is my body, broken for you. Now, that wasn't really his body, but it was a symbol he used, right? It was a symbol of saying, every time you eat this, remember me. So every time you have lunch, every time you eat a bowl of oatmeal, maybe you have some bread sometimes, remember me. So I've been thinking about wheat. So this is not quite a pound of wheat I have right here. And I'm wondering, how many grains of wheat do you think is in this? I'm not counting either. Hundreds, maybe thousands. Anybody want to make a guess?
1,522.
1,589. 1,000 on the dot. Somewhere around there. Actually, right here are about 3,000 grains of wheat. 3,000. Well, in our scripture this morning, we heard Jesus saying, take this. He said, peace be with you. He said to his disciples, peace be with you. And then he sent them out. He sent them out to do his work. He said, as the Father has sent me, so I send you. Like every person was like a grain of wheat that he was sending out. Here, do you want to take a little bit? You can even chew on it if you want, or you can just hold it. That every person in this world is like a grain of wheat. Do you want a little bit, Will? No?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. That every person is like a grain of wheat. That Jesus sent them out into the world to serve, to love. The wheat reminds me that every person is like a grain of wheat, that every person matters, that every person deserves love. And this wheat, to make flour, needs to be ground up. It's a little nutty tasting. Yeah. It tastes like flour. Yeah. Well, I have here, so in a cup of flour, it takes about 1,750 grains of wheat to make a cup of flour. So while the sermon is going on, I want you guys to figure out, I have 9 cups of flour here. I don't know if we'll use it all, but we have 9 cups of flour, and I wonder how many grains of wheat it might have taken. 1,750. So you can work on that. But we're going to have communion today, and then during our Sunday school time, 9. During our Sunday school time, I'm going to make some dough. I'm going to need some dough during the sermon. And then we're going to take that dough, and you guys are going to be able to shape it into little rolls, into little loaves. But really, what I want you to remember today is that the wheat that becomes flour, that becomes bread, is all about us remembering Jesus' call to love our neighbors, to love God through loving our neighbors, that he sent his disciples out to do good works, and he sends us out, that every grain matters. Every person in your classroom, every person in your family, everybody you meet is a child of God. So I'm wondering if you guys will help me get this dough started.
Oh, no, there's 5,700.
Yes.
What, 5,000?
No, 1,700.
All right, you guys are good at remembering. I don't want the answer right now. I want the answer later. I can't think about that many things at once. So let's see. Will you hold it? One thing at a time, everybody. That math problem is really. So I have some water with a little sweetener, and we're going to take some yeast. Let's see. Alethea, can you stir that yeast up for me? Let's see. And Ben, do you want to pour this warm water into this bowl? Pour the rest of the water in there. And let's see, I have some salt that we're gonna add. Do you wanna dump the salt in there, Jonas? In here. Okay, you can just let that sit, Alethea, and we'll see if that starts to rise. Hopefully I had the temperature just right. Let's see, Timo, will you hold the spoon for me? And we're gonna pour a little bit of olive oil into this bread. There you go. There we go. It is. Look at that oil in there. And what else do we need? What are we missing?
Flour.
We need flour, don't we? Lots of flour. So let's see. Will you dump that flour in there for me? Thanks. Let's see. Who wants to start stirring? So why don't you stir a little bit, Timo, and then hand the spoon. Let's see. Ellie, you want to help me dump this flour in there? There we go. Keep stirring. Jonas, who else wants to dump a little flour in? I'm sorry, that wasn't. Timo, you want to hand the spoon off to somebody else? Here, why don't we?
Alethea first.
Yep. Let's see. Here, Will. It feels kind of weird. Oh, we don't usually do this during children's time. Have any of you guys ever made bread?
Yeah.
I like to eat dough.
You like to eat dough?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Especially making gluten-free water and chocolate cookies.
Wow, I love dough too.
Chocolate chip.
So I am going to keep mixing it. And look, it looks like the yeast is about ready to go in. You see how the yeast kind of got a little bit bigger? Alethea, will you mix that liquid in for me? So I want you guys to remember this week, when you eat bread, when you come up, if you come up for communion later today, that communion, we take this bread.
That smells delicious, but it makes me feel like I'm
going to
puke.
Oh my. I want you to remember this week that that this flour is made up of lots and lots of grains of wheat. Yeah, I don't want the answer yet. I don't want the answer yet. You guys all got to figure it out. That's great, thanks. So before you do the math, let's think about the way Jesus loves us and calls us to go forth and to spread that love. So I shouldn't have given you that math problem until the end. Now that's all you're thinking about. But let's have a prayer together before you guys go back. Jesus, may we love as you loved. May we recognize that each one of us is like a grain of wheat that when put together can nourish the world. Thank you for each one here. May we go forth and do your work. In your holy name, amen. All right, you guys can go back and make sure after church to go downstairs and help make some dough. Well, I'm going to continue this work, but first I'm going to wash my hands so that I can... There were a lot of little logistical pieces to think about how to do this today. But this idea of bread, this symbol of bread, the symbol of life, it just feels so rich to me. Like it has a lot to say. But I want to go back. I'm a messy kneader, so I thought I'd better bring an apron. Let's go back into our scripture. I'm going to see if I can continue to work and to talk at the same time. Our scripture started out when it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples met were locked. They were locked for fear. Fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he showed them his hands and his sides, and the disciples rejoiced. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit." What a story. In John's gospel, there's no waiting the 50 days for Pentecost. No, in John's gospel, they receive the Holy Spirit right there on Easter evening. In Luke and in Acts, it's a public event that happens in the midst of Jerusalem. But here we are in John's gospel, and they are breathed on up in a locked room full of fear. So different from that setting in Acts where the Holy Spirit descends like tongues of fire. Well, we are here in this gospel reading this morning at the end of Easter. The day is turning into night. The sun is fading. Earlier in this gospel reading, what came right before this one would have been Mary going to the tomb early in the morning, and then John, the other disciple, and Peter running to the tomb and finding the cloths there and nothing else. We're told that somehow they believe. We're not sure what they believed, but they believed. And here they are that evening, together, huddled, doors locked for fear. And Jesus stands among them. He stood among them, we're told. Not in front of them, not going ahead of them like last week's gospel. No, he is among them, meeting them in their places of fear. And what does he say? Peace be with you. After looking and probing and making sure that it was really him, the disciples rejoiced. What sweet relief they must have felt. That joy they must have felt. How did that poem reading go? It was something about when love starts. It's in that moment of love that joy begins. So there are the disciples, relieved, joyful, astonished at Jesus standing there with them. And Jesus says again, "Peace be with you." And he goes on, "As the Father has sent me, so I send you." No time for nostalgia, no time to process what they've seen, what they've heard, what's standing in front of them. No, Jesus prepares them right away to carry on his work, to take up his work in new ways. He breathes on them, we're told, giving them the Holy Spirit. "Receive it, take it," he tells them. And he goes on, "If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. And if you retain the sins of any, they are retained." Those lines of "if you forgive" and "if you retain," they can make me cringe. They hold so much potential power, so much potential abuse. To give humans, those frail disciples who were so clueless at times, to give them the power to forgive or not forgive, I wonder what's going on here. Jesus knows those sitting there huddled in fear that they have faltered. And yet he says to them, "If you forgive." I'm tempted to skip over these lines. I'm tempted to go right in to Thomas. But this morning I want to spend a little bit of time here. I want to look at it, what it might have to say to us today. And before we begin, I want to recognize that forgiveness is complicated. Forgiveness can take years or decades. Forgiveness does not come easily, and I don't want to pretend it does. And yet there's something here that these disciples needed to hear that night. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you, as the Father has sent me, so I send you." And he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. And if you retain the sins of any, they are retained." Well, you know me, I like to go in and look at Greek words. That word translated here as forgive, aphaimi, means to forgive like as a debt, like we hear in the Lord's Prayer. But it's also got a broader meaning. That word to forgive can translate as to let go, or to release, or to allow. So hear it in this way. If you let go of the sins of any, they are released. If you let go of the sins of any, they are released. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. Forgiving here is about letting go, of releasing. Retaining, too, is another word with much depth. In Greek, krateo, the broader meaning of that word means to take hold of, to seize, to hold fast. So if you let go of the faults of any, they are released. If you hold on to the failures of others, they are seized. They are held on to tightly. As we think of these words, I want us to remember that this gospel, just like all the books, the letters, the things written in our scriptures, that this gospel was written to a particular people at a particular place in time. John's community in the days when this gospel were written were suffering from being banished from the synagogue. They were part of a Jewish community who was shunning them because of their beliefs, telling them they no longer belonged. So I wonder, might the resurrected Jesus here in this gospel be telling his listeners what was needed of them, what was needed of them to go on and do the work of Christ, to not be bitter, to not be resentful, but to release and forgive. That in order to go forth and to be sent out to share Christ's love, that first they had to work on themselves. I imagine in that room that night, Peter and John and Andrew and the others also had some forgiving to do. Forgiving themselves, forgiving one another, forgiving the Romans and the temple authorities, their Jewish brothers. In order for any of us to do the work of love, forgiveness feels like that might be a starting place. Must we start with forgiving? And it is part of that is creating space to find our way to the table, to the communion table, to break bread with one another, to share in the love and joy of receiving. So much forgiving to do. Each of us have made small missteps, maybe some large ones. I think of all the tragedies that are happening. And I wonder, how have I harmed you? How have we harmed one another? How have we sinned against those in our own community, in our own families? How have relationships been broken? It says to me, we all have work to do. We all seize up and hold on, and we're invited to open, to be made into something new, just like every grain of wheat that is crushed and made into something new. Each little grain that adds to this loaf of bread here, it matters. And how we do this matters too. It matters what kind of flour is used. It matters that the yeast is not too old. I've made plenty of loaves of bread that have not turned out very good. How we do it matters. This bread flour happens to be a flour that's high in gluten. High in gluten. Gluten is actually two proteins that, when mixed with water, turn into gluten. And gluten gives the bread the ability to stretch, to be resilient, to be changed. This bread that Jesus says when we eat communion, take, eat, this is my body. We are to go forth resilient, stretched, changed. That's the work of the gospel in us and through us. The more that bread dough is kneaded, the looser and stronger those gluten strands become. Kneading stretches it more and more so that it has the capacity to not break. I wonder what those disciples, what those in John's community needed to be resilient and not break. I wonder if forgiveness was a little bit like the gluten that helped them stretch, that helped them find space and to see one another, to see God in one another. Well, my friends, this bread that nourishes us, this bread that reminds us that we are to go forth and do the work of Christ, that we are to be his body. We can't touch the wounds in his side. We can't see the nail scars on his hands. But we can look at one another. We can take bread and break it together and remind each other that we are all on this journey together, that we are all created in God's image. We can all be nourished by it so we can go forth in love. And that begins with naming our own failures. It begins with asking forgiveness of God and each other. May it be so. May we rise like this dough and nourish one another in all that we do. Amen. I'm going to offer this dough to Bethany. Bethany's going to take it downstairs. We're hoping for a little bit of a quick rise so that we can bake it a little bit later together. I'm going to just wash my hands again. Consider, what does it mean to nourish one another? What does it mean for you to forgive and to ask forgiveness? What does that look like for us here today? As we move into a time of communion, I invite you to join me in a confession. It's found in Voices Together 893 or here on your screen. So join me in the dark print. Let us confess together. For failing to love others as you have loved us, God of grace, for wasting your gifts and hoarding our goods, God of grace, for plundering the earth and abusing the planet, God of grace, for fearing those who are strange to us and ignoring those in need, God of grace, for losing heart and abandoning hope, God of grace, for all the ways we turn from you, God of grace. We offer our prayers in the name of the one who saves, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Amen. We come in the name of the one who forgives, who saves, who welcomes us. And we enter into this time of communion not because we deserve it, but because we're hungry. We come because we need to be made as one body, that we need to celebrate that idea that we are one grain of many, and that that's what makes this loaf. So you are invited to this table of remembering, where we remember that night when Jesus took the loaf. He took that loaf with his disciples after eating, after giving thanks, and he broke it. He broke it and he said to them, take, receive, eat. This is my body broken for you. And then after the meal, when they were done eating, he took the cup. He took the wine and said, drink. This is my blood shed for you. Every time you drink of it, remember me. Remember that you are part of the body. Remember. So as we prepare to take, I invite you to join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day, forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We have both wheat bread today and gluten-free bread. You are invited to come up and take a piece of the bread, take the cup, and go back to your seats, and we will partake together. So I invite the communion servers to come forward now. The gluten-free bread will be on the piano side. Yes, that's gluten-free. Kathy, I will hand that to you. That's regular. Thank you. My friends, you are not welcome to this table because you have everything together and you know the way. You are welcome to this table as seekers, as those who come hungry for the love of Christ, those who come hungry for a different way. So come, receive, be blessed. The table is ready. Come and eat. My friends, we take these crumbs of bread and we eat together as one body. So take and eat. Be blessed. Just as Jesus took and shared the cup, we drink together as one body, forgiven and loved. Join me in prayer as we end. O God, you meet us in our hungering with manna not of our own making. And in our thirsting, you surprise us with unexpected wine. You, O Holy One, are the source of our desiring and the end of all of our longing. O giver of the feast, blessed be. Amen. God's people said, Amen.
Voices together, number 660. The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me down to lie in pastures green. He leadeth me the quiet waters by. My soul he doth restore again, and me to walk doth make within the paths of righteousness in for his own name's sake. Yea, though I walk in death's dark veil, yet will I fear none ill, for thou art with me, and thy rod and staff me comfort still. My table thou hast furnished in presence of my foes. My head thou dost with oil anoint, and my cup goodness and mercy all my life shall surely follow me, and in God's house
we are going to start off announcements with Joel this morning.
I know we're running late, so I'll keep it short, but we're getting ready in May to fill our positions for the church year. So I just wanted to say, you know, on a given Sunday morning, it could be 11 or more people, not including Kate, helping to make our worship meaningful. And you can see, Ben, slide please. You can see all the different kinds of people it takes to make that happen. And that doesn't even count, please slide, the folks that are working ahead of time to make sure our church is clean, to make sure worship is planned, are doing our bulletins, our beautiful visuals. So that's a lot. And then, slide, all the committees and positions that handle all the other duties that make UMC a unique community, pastoral care, overseeing our budget and our building, handling administrative tasks, and more. And then slide, our mission outreach is also key to our identity. So we have all these different reps that either sit on boards or interact with these other ministries and keep our church informed about what's going on. So that's a lot. And it doesn't just happen by itself. It takes work and it takes effort and gifts from all kinds of individuals. So in May, we're going to hold a congregational meeting to fill these these positions for our church year that begins in September. And you'll hear more about the process in the coming week. But I just wanted to start you all to ponder over the next weeks where you might fit in and where your gifts might be used in the work of UMC. So thank you.
And Joel, thank you for the many ways, from working in the back to doing the bulletin to being chair of leadership team. But there's a place for each one. Are there other announcements that need to be shared this morning?
There are two more tickets for the creation and a little sign back there that Vonda and I will not be able to use, so they're free for anyone. And the table back here.
So yesterday, the boys and I took all of those coins in a big bin to the MCC relief sale in Harrisburg. We could barely carry them in. It was a big bin. And everyone oohed and aahed when we brought it in. And we took guesses on the way, how many coins are gonna be in this bin? And I guessed 200, Ben guessed maybe 135. We were around that range. It turned out there were $685 in that bin. So thank you all for your generosity. Thank you, kids, for collecting those coins week after week. That is going to provide a lot of water for a lot of thirsty people. So thank you so much. And I will send out an email this week with the exact number. That's the one that sticks in my head, but numbers don't stick in my head very well. So I will send you the exact number by email this week. I also want to say to the kids, after church, if you guys come downstairs, maybe grab your cookie and come downstairs, we have some dough down there that needs to be made into rolls, and you can shape it in whatever way you'd like to make a roll. So come on downstairs pretty soon after church. I know it's fun to run around, but if you get down there soon, we can make our rolls and shape them, so we'll have time to bake them and eat them.
And others can go downstairs. Coffee is downstairs this morning. Grab a cup of coffee, visit down there a bit, and then we will talk about communion together as an intergenerational group. Any birthdays or anniversaries? Are there more announcements to make? Visitors with us.
Yesterday, Carolyn and Rodney and I also went to the MCC relief sale in Harrisburg, and three people asked to be remembered and to say hello, former members, Ken and Yvonne Martin and Mary Ellen Martin. Ken has been the chair of the board of the MCC relief sale for about 15 years, and as of yesterday, his volunteer position came to an end.
Birthdays or anniversaries this week?
Birthday from Fidel. I had my birthday yesterday, and I thank God for the gift of life, and thank you for prayer.
Evelyn?
I think David Bepler just had a birthday as well.
Fidel and Dave. Let's sing Happy Birthday, Friends.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear friends. Happy birthday to you.
My friends, I invite you to stand for the benediction. Eternal God, you call us to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out with courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us. Through Jesus Christ, amen. Go in peace.